1 hour every week starting from 11 September 2020. And this is, as you know, the second of the series. The first one was held on 11 September 2020, in which a former alumni of our college, Dr. Shibu Jose, director and associate dean, University of Missouri, delivered a thought-provoking lecture on the paradigm shift in focus and nomenclature of courses happening in North America in the sphere of natural resource management, including forestry, agriculture, and fisheries, in tune with the demand and prospects of the climate. And today's speaker is the Noel Thomas IFS, Inspector General of Forests, Ministry of Environment, Forests and Climate Change. As many of us know, he was a former faculty also of this college, who taught core forestry courses to many of the senior faculty of this college. Before I request Noel, sir, to deliver the lecture and to introduce him to you, I have the honor and privilege to welcome our respected dean, CTS Nair sir, and all other dignitaries in the group. Warm welcome to all of you once again. I welcome our dean, beloved dean and peer of Noel sir, at the beginning phase of this college, who was spearheading all the activities of the college, and also for taking keen interest in organizing this webinar. Also welcome all the university officers, the director of education, Dr. S. Gobokumar, then the special officer of the academic climate change education, Mr. Dr. P. O. Namir, associate director of forestry, KU, Dr. T.K. Kunyamu, sir, all other senior faculty, senior and junior faculty, and all others who have joined for this webinar session. And a brief introduction about today's speaker, Sri Noel Thomas IFS. He belongs to the 1991 IFS batch, and he was ranked second All India on the All India basis. And he belongs to the Kerala cadre currently, and is in the rank as an additional principal chief conservator for the Government of Kerala. Currently, he is serving in Delhi as the Inspector General of Forest, Forest Policy Division, and is also the IGF Project Elephant Division. Project Elephant Division, Ministry of Environment and Forest and Climate Change, Government of India. About his educational training and qualification, he is an MSc degree holder in botany with a rank. He also has an MBA in finance and a PGPPM from the IIM Bangalore. Has attended several public policy international perspective programs in international universities like the Syracuse University, USA, and also attended the program on leadership and strategic thinking from Cambridge University, UK. He attended exchange programs on ecosystem payment services at Catskills, USA, and forest inventory at the GTAC, Salt Lake City, Utah, USA. He had also attended the UNFF training in NLBIS at Nairobi, Kenya. Attended the Indo-Australian Habitat Studies training program on PPP in housing and infrastructure in Australia and New Zealand. He has a very long career spanning not only for the sphere of forestry, but also from abroad in outer the state of Kerala. He actually began his career as an assistant professor in forestry of this university from 1986 up to 1991. We had the good fortune to be his students, many of the senior faculty here. He was also the principal of the Kerala Forest School, Valayar Palakkad, Kerala, during 1996, and served as deputy conservator of forests in various divisions of the state. He also was the managing director of the Rehabilitation Plantation Limited, Punalur, belong to the Government of India and Government of Kerala. Also was a member of the Kerala State Pollution Control Board during 2000 to 2001. He was Housing Commissioner, Government of Kerala, and Secretary, Kerala State Housing Board from 2006 to 2011. He was also Director of the Kerala State Nirmadi Kendra with additional charge, and he was also very importantly did a very excellent job, as I have heard from others, as a director and CEO of the NORCA Roots, NORCA department from 2011 to September 2013. He was director, Ministry of Overseas Indian Affairs, Government of India from 10 2013 to 2 2016. He was also director OI, Ministry of the External Affairs, Government of India, during 2016. He was also the direct deputy inspector general of forest policy at the Ministry of Environment and Forest during 2016 to 2018. And from 2018, he had been serving as the Inspector General of Forest for the Forest Policy and Project Elephant, two portfolios put together. And in fact, we all know that, you know, at one more point of time when we studied forestry, we used to mention who was the first Inspector General of Forest of India, and it was Detlef Brandis, and he was German. But now we have our own former faculty who is one of the Inspector General of the Forest. Before I request Noel sir to take the mic to speak, I request our respected Dean Dr. Vidyasagar sir to welcome the guest speaker and also the audience. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Anoop. Respected Sri Noel Thomas, Inspector General of Forest, MOF and CC, Government of India, and the guest speaker of today, Dr. E.V. Anoop, moderator of the session, Dr. C.T.S. Nair, sir, Sri Abhilash Damodaran, AFS, respected participants and other dignitaries who are all attending this seminar. Good morning to all. Today, we are going to have our second talk in webinar series, The Impact of Forest Policies in Sustainable Forest Management by Sri Noel Thomas, AFS. As we all know, policies are guidelines for the government and the people and help in making various decisions. Forests are a vital part of any nation, not only for the commercial value, but also for the quality of life that it ensures. The first forest policy was in the year 1894, which gave priority to agriculture over forest. It was in 1952 National Forest Policy that the target of 33% of the total land to be covered by forest was established. This National Forest Policy was replaced by the National Forest Policy of 1988. This policy was emphasized on the conservation of our existing forest through reforestation and soil conservation. The principal aim of the forest policy must be to ensure the environmental stability and maintenance of ecological balance, including atmospheric equilibrium, which is vital for sustenance of all life forms. The derivation of direct economic benefit must be subordinated to this principal aim. Similarly, the principle of sustainable management is that resource consumption cannot exceed resource production over time. We traditionally considered wealth to be material wealth embodied in goods and services. Sustainability challenges us to consider wealth in terms of environmental assets and services, as well as community attributes that contribute to our well-being. Like other natural systems, our forests can be evaluated in light of these assets too. Conversion of primary forest to managed growth may involve reductions in natural capital stock. The substitution of investments in constructed capital or human capital for natural capital. Policies promoting this substitution have largely been implemented under the notion that it enhanced overall wealth by the production of material goods and services. Today, a different conclusion regarding forest management might be reached. When one uses a broader definition of wealth and the concept of intergenerational equity, the question is that, can we substitute and constructed capital for natural capital to enhance wealth? To what extent can such substitution occur? Current discussion of sustainability raises concerns about the irreversible loss of species, cultures, and knowledge. I hope some of these questions will be discussed in this webinar by the guest speaker. With these few words, I extend a very warm welcome to Sri Noel Thomas, the guest speaker of today, to this webinar. In fact, I am very happy to disclose that Sri Noel Thomas was my colleague in College of Forestry before joining Indian Forest Service. I extend a very warm welcome to Dr. CTS Nair sir. He was also present in the last session and interacted with us. And I also welcome Sri Abhilash Damodaran. He is also going to speak in this webinar series. And I extend all welcome to all the officers and all the participants and other dignitaries who are attending this webinar. I welcome Dr. Anup also, Professor and Head Department of Forest Products and Utilization and moderator of this session to this meeting. Already he has introduced and I think I request Dr. Noyd Thomas to speak about the subject and then we will have interaction later on because Dr. CTS Nair sir, Sri Abhilash and other dignitaries are also present here. I request Dr. Noyd Thomas to speak on their topic. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. Before I request another session, I would request people to put your comments in the chat box. If you have any questions in the chat box, and also you're welcome to you know, as you have put it, you'll not be presenting a slideshow. It will be rather an interactive session. He'll be speaking to you directly without the help of the PowerPoint. So as Vidya sir have told important people and all other you know, those who are keen to put their questions directly can ask raise your hands and interfere in between if you wish. Others can type in all your questions in the chat box. We'll be taking them one by one once okay. I think there is a presentation coming up. I don't know, is it from Noel sir or Noel sir, are you presenting or
it's somebody
mute edittana samsariche
somebody
alle
I think
seri okay
no sir Noel sir are you presenting or someone else is presenting no,
somebody else has I think somebody has come
yeah actually I request Shahji or no coordinators to just mute the person to put a screen off because Noel sir is going to speak. Okay, then now it's fine. Okay. Sir, welcome once again. We can start the session now, Noel sir.
Yeah. Good morning. First of all, I thank the Agriculture University College of Forestry, the Associate Dean Sri Vidya Sagar, Sri Anup. And our esteemed CTS the dignitaries as invited. It's a pleasure for me to interact today. Mr. Vidya Sagar called me and informed that such a web our series is being conducted by the College of Forestry. The forestry students, others are interested in forest management in the country. So, I feel that you know, it's like a homecoming to me because as Vidya Sagar and Anu mentioned, I started my official career in Kerala Agri University as an assistant professor. It's almost now going to be around 35 years of long academic as well as administrative service in the field of forestry and other sectors. I was fortunate, I would say that I was rather fortunate and getting opportunities in other sectors also. That has further added to my knowledge and to my understanding of how policies are made. And I had the opportunity to work in various other departments in the state Kerala, starting with the Commercial Plantation Corporation. Again, I had the opportunity to work as member in the Pollution Control Board. Thereafter, as a long tenure, I would say, perhaps one who has completed 5 years as a commissioner housing. The whole period of the government, I had worked as housing commissioner. Thereafter, I had the opportunity to work in the NRA department, or Non-Resident Kerala Affairs Department in Kerala, for almost 3 years, where I could initiate many welfare programs for the non-repatriates, especially repatriates from Gulf countries, etc. Then I joined Government of India in the Ministry of Overseas Indian Affairs. So for looking after the welfare of the diaspora community of the country, so I was Director Diaspora Division in the Government of India, where we have been looking after the welfare issues, other problems, the issues of the workers. All these things were looked after by us. Thereafter, I joined our cadre ministry, or home ministry, you can say, the Ministry of Environment and Forests, as a Deputy Inspector General. So I was fortunate to get the policy division, which is very important, I would say, the think tank division of the ministry. So followed by that, in 2018, I got the opportunity to continue as the Inspector General. In addition, I was given another charge of the conserving, looking after managing the elephant conservation in the country, which used to be managed by one Inspector General. So all these things gave me an insight into the working of the government machinery work in the state as well as in the center, which I could use productively for presenting the country position in the various international forums, because I led the Indian delegation to the UN Forum on Forests, the last two sessions, as the national focal point of the country. And I had also the opportunity to lead the delegation to the Asia Pacific Forestry Commission, and also to the Committee of Forestry. These are the all the major forums and committees I had the opportunity to represent the country. So, and currently I am closely associated, rather from the beginning of the revision of the National Forest Policy in 1988. So you know that this was in news, you can say. Now I realize that with what I learned in the public policy program in IIM Bangalore, so it's all I could use to the best of benefit for formulating the forest policy. It was almost, now we can say it's almost ready, waiting for final approval. So coming back to the topic which I will be speaking on, it's forest policies and the management of forests in the country. And we should also look back and some 100 years plus, where scientific forest management in the country started in the 1860s. That mainly after the appointment of the first Inspector General of Forest, Mr. Brandis. So I have the honor of holding or becoming an Inspector General. I can say that, like Brandis also, I also became, or I also held the position of Inspector General here in the ministry. So thereafter, we all know that the first national forest policy, the British India, we can the forest policy of 1894. So that set the tone for the scientific management of Indian forests. We all know that. The scientific management of Indian forests started through various management measures based on the policy prescriptions of the 1894. In the 1894 forest policy, the major focus was on how the benefits, maximum benefits could be derived from the resource, the forest resources of the country. At the same time, there was proposal to ensure that the local requirements, local needs of the people are met. At the same time, the revenue from the forests are ensured for the regime, British regime, because forest was mainly looked upon as a source of revenue during that time, and the 1894 policy was framed in tune with that. And thereafter, the Imperial Forest Service was constituted, then followed by the scientific research and management, starting with the starting of Forest Research Institute of India in 1906 for conducting research on silviculture, forest utilization, as well as resource mapping, etc. This was very essential for scientific management of forests in the country. So the British government was very particular, very prompt in implementing the policy prescriptions of the 1894. So we should remember that during that time we had about 90 million. It's almost around 28% of our land area was under forest during that time. In the early 1900, it was around 90 million hectares. So, and subsequently, because of the requirement for the local people as well as for the raising revenue, the first Indian Forest Act was made in 1927 with a clear mandate for the administrative regime how to manage, and the legal backing was given for realizing the revenue. The Indian Forest Act 1927 is a major tool for management of the how the legal instrument was used for managing forests to achieve the scientific management of forests in the country. The reserved forest was there mainly for ensuring the one thing for revenue as well as for ensuring services for the local people. We had the protected forest is mostly for the rights given to the local population, and unless it is prohibited. And the village forest is exclusively, you can say, the participatory forest management. Everything was there that time also through village forest, and the communities or the villages where the reserve forests were transferred to them for this purpose, and the regional, the states and other regional entities were able to make the rules for that, for the benefit of the local people. So that time itself, during the British time also, the local requirement, local needs were taken care of through the policy prescriptions as well as through the legal instruments. Thereafter, we know that the 1952 forest policy, the first forest policy of independent India, came through with more focus on working of forests, and we all know that that was a time the country was facing lot of food security issues, and the famine, all those things were there, and people were suffering. So the major focus was for promoting agriculture. So large scale diversion of the forest happened during that period. If you see the how the forest transition took place in terms of extent, you can see how it gradually came. Then suddenly in the 50s, the diversion for the other purposes, basically for agriculture and for rapid infrastructure development, roads, dams, electricity projects, railways, and so on. All this accelerated diversion resulted in large-scale deforestation as well as clearance of forests. So we should know that the forest policy, which is the backbone of all your decisions, the all your management plans, working plans, all are based on the prescriptions of the forest policy to achieve the objectives set in the policy prescription. And so the respective forest policies, the first 1894, the 1952 policies, all followed the prescriptions given in the policy. So that there comes the importance of the policy document. Then once as we moved on to the 70s and 80s, we can clearly see that 70s with the Rio conference, we all know that the conservation movement, the momentum on conservation, and the more focus was on given to conservation rather than the economic benefits. So in India also, it had its own repercussions. You know that the most first act for the wildlife conservation, 1972, it has been in the first act was formulated in 1972. After the Rio conference, understanding that the conservation of the wildlife, wild flora and fauna, is very important for the security, food security, as well as ecological security of the country. So that made a drastic change in the management of the wild flora and fauna. Thereafter, we know that the National Commission on Agriculture in 1976 made many prescriptions for supporting agriculture as well as enhancing the forest and tree cover in the country. So thereafter, we all know that it's history now. It's you can say that the landmark 1980 Forest Conservation Act, with a very small act, how it could change the whole conservation or management, forest management scenario in the country. So that 1980 Act has proved that even a small act can change the whole management or how the sector will move ahead. So I would say that perhaps we should thank the then Prime Minister for the foresightedness for bringing such an act, even though it's a very small, such an effective act, when lakhs of hectares used to be, on an average, used to be diverted before 1980. So if you see, on an average, now it has come down to, it's only around 1 million hectare, you can say, in the last 40 years. So you can see the impact of this act, Central Act, because that has this has resulted due to the fact that in 1976 the forest and wildlife was brought under concurrent list, where center can legislate, and the legislation brought in by central government will be having precedence over the state legislations. So that made all the change, and now we are in a situation that in the early 80s, our forest area, which came down to around 19% of the geographic area of the country, around 64 million hectares, now we have reached in 2020, it's the latest 2019 assessment of the forest cover, say that we are about 71 million hectares in forest cover, as well as around 9.8 million hectares in tree cover outside the tree outside forest, which means around 80% forest and tree cover in the country. So we can say that 24.5% of the geographical area of the country is under some form of forest and tree cover to ensure the ecological benefits, ecological security of the country. And I am very happy to share that the forest cover is growing at a rate of around 2 lakh hectare or 2000 square kilometer every year. And our carbon stock is also increasing by around the addition every year, an addition of around 20 million ton in the carbon stock also is increasing. So it's a healthy progress now. This has been achieved through a mix of basically I would say that the 1988 policy, this is a landmark, policy as far as forest management is concerned in India, and where it was very clearly mentioned that the economic benefits shall be subservient to the ecological benefits. So the preservation, the policy used the term preservation, saying that certain areas, certain delicate ecosystems should be preserved without any human interference. And thereafter, conservation. Conservation, as we all know, that conservation is different from preservation. Conservation is a judicious use of your resource, conserving your resource at the same time, ensuring the incremental benefits from the resource without harming the principle. So that is a sustainable forest management also. So now we are in such a situation. We have a healthy growth of forest as far as forest cover area, forest cover as well as tree cover. The carbon stock is growing, but still it is not sufficient, because our aim is, our goal set in the National Forest Policy of 88 is 1/3 of the geographical area. So we have to go much ahead now. So we need to grow much faster. At least, if not the forest cover, we should ensure that the tree cover, which is equally important, if not from the biodiversity point of view, but from the other benefits, ecological benefits that come from the trees and other vegetation. I think we should I would say that the forest policies over the years, especially the last forest policy of 1988, made a drastic change to how we see our forests and wildlife, how we manage our forests and wildlife for the benefit of our ecological security of the millions of people in the country. Now I'll come to the revision of the 1988 forest policy, in which I am fully involved right from 2016. We all know that when a policy is made, when a policy for any sector is made, usually it happens that it is said that a policy is made when an idea whose time has come. So suddenly we say that, okay, we have to have a policy or on particular issue or sector. So an idea comes up, then we start making the policy prescriptions for achieving the goals and objectives or that how to operationalize that idea. That's how the policies are made in any country. So that was the same with the revision of this 88 policy also. We had commissioned the Indian Institute of Forest Management to conduct the field exercises, field consultations, large number of regional state level consultations were made. Thereafter, a draft policy document was made in 2016. Then the policy draft was put up for public consultation, in which we received thousands of comments. And basically, then we realized that policy making is not an easy task, and satisfying the demands, the accommodating the views of different stakeholders. I would say that I understood when we were taught about the policy making, I never thought that it is such a difficult task. And that also, especially for a sector like forest and wildlife, which you are effectively making a policy for a quarter of your geographical area of the country. And you can imagine the number of stakeholders. It was quite alarming. See, basically, I would say that, broadly, we can say the conservation-oriented, then the livelihood stakeholders, especially the tribals, other traditional forest dwellers, and people who were slightly annoyed with the 88 policy, especially the developmental side, infrastructural side, their pressure. And balancing the requirements of all different stakeholders, and people, very extreme people took extreme positions, that people said that you should drastically increase your protected area network so that we should increase our no-go areas much, instead of the 5%, we should bring it to 10% for ensuring the ecological services for the humanity. Then we all know that the Forest Rights Act 2006, that came in between the issues related to, and the Tribal Welfare Activists, all in other NGOs, all pitched for putting the essence, action points of the Forest Rights Act into the forest policy itself. So basically, and the developmental side, and they went, the earlier 88 policy said strict restraint on diversion. So people want that strict restraint to be removed. That word should not be there in the new policy. So it was like a policy making. In the meanwhile, so many sectors, many policies came up and got through the cabinet. But however, the forest policy alone, I would say that the number of times it has gone up for approval of the cabinet. So that shows that the pressure, pull, and expectations and demands of different stakeholders are very important, and satisfying each and everyone demand or requirement is rather a very difficult proposition, which we understood while going for the revision of the 1988 policy. But all said and done, we have been able to take a balanced approach because people were opposing public private participation in forestry sector, even for taking up pilot projects in the forestry sector, because we all know that resource crunch, financial resources as well as human resources, the priority wise, you know, forestry sector is lacking, and the priority is also when you allocate the resources, forestry sector hardly get around 1% of the GDP of the country, whereas the its contribution itself now, a very conservative estimation by different people say that it's around not less than 4-5% of the GDP is contributed at a very conservative estimate. Because if you take the ecosystem services, you know, forget about the timber and fuel wood, we are still, our national accounting system is still with the timber and fuel wood and other removals. So that is not much, because maybe around, they say it's around 1% something. But much more, now the focus is on non-timber forest produce as well as ecosystem services. So our sector and our the contribution of our sector to agriculture and horticulture as well as other supporting other sectors, that contribution, and even ensuring the health and well-being of the people. So these things are not getting factored into our national accounting system. Like, anyhow, now they have started the process. Now the national accounting system, they are trying to incorporate natural capital accounting. Now they are planning to take up this exercise also. Hopefully, maybe in the future, this also will get its truly whatever the resources will be get accounted, and the services also will get accounted, so that the forestry sector will get a better consideration in the days to come. Then in this context, I would also like to add that in the last few Finance Commission allocations, it is a welcome step, because states were complaining about the opportunities lost for developing their states using the forest areas. So the Finance Commission, 14th Finance Commission, said 7.5% of the additional central assistance will be given to states which maintain good forest cover. So that was a new, you can say it's a new development towards conservation and development of the forestry sector in the country. But the problem is that since it was not a like specifically tied to a particular that it should be spent or utilized for the benefit and improvement of forest, so states had the, of course, states should have the freedom to decide the priorities. So unfortunately, we could not get enough allocation out of this additional central assistance from the states. So that is also an issue that has been also taken up in the new Finance Commission, 15th Finance Commission. So the problem is Finance Commission is also constrained to make it a tied sort of fund, so that the priorities, you know, that will become another issue. So as of now, the additional central assistance is given. It is expected that states, through their local bodies, basically the local bodies should be able to plan and implement programs and schemes for the benefit and welfare of the people of the area. So that's also it's a good development, and we should also be getting benefit of this additional central allocation through the Finance Commission awards. So as of now, I would say the revision of the forest policy, national forest policy, may happen. I wish that it should happen at the earliest, but it is at the consideration of the highest level now. In fact, many times it was considered, but every time, you know, India, now only I understood that how the pressures pull, and it was the day of decision, again it gets postponed. So you can imagine the type of pressure is coming up on our sectoral policy or policy decision making. So anyway, that's all administrative issues. Hopefully, we are very hopeful that we have taken care of the requirements of all the sectors, by especially maybe I would say now the people-centric, I would say this forest proposed revision is more of people-centric, especially safeguarding the interests of tribals, the other forest dwellers, as well as the around 300 million plus rural population who are more or less directly dependent on our forestry resources in the country. And now there are the management also would be looking on a landscape. The now we have proposed that forest management should be on a not basically administrative boundary. It will not be good to have a administrative units will be there, but the prescriptions, management prescriptions and programs should be on a landscape basis, so that the concerns other sectors, agriculture, horticulture and pisciculture and so on, all these sectors also will be taken care of or should be benefited through the various interventions in the landscape, especially in the forest areas, so that there will be a total development of the landscape itself. So a landscape-based plants, catchment area treatments, and soil moisture conservation, invasive species management, then the people's participation, especially through tribals, as well as the giving the statutory rights, ensuring that their statutory rights are protected and not infringed. All these prescriptions we have given. And again, the education, forestry education, research, all we have suggested say that focus and orientation should be there, and the institutions should be upgraded, both infrastructure as well as human resource also should be upgraded, and training of all the stakeholders, not only the forestry personnel, all other stakeholders also should get trained in and this skilling of forest dependent population, and periodic review. And we also said that all the finance should come from different sectors. It should be a convergence of various sectoral activities in the as far as forest areas are concerned. So the fund should come from different sources for maintaining and managing the landscapes. And there is provision for periodic review, which was not there in the earlier policies. We suggested that there should be a periodic review 3 years and 5 years. So there is ample scope for mid-term correction also, because policy is a dynamic. It should be a dynamic document, so that anytime if you want course correction, that should be possible. And we should not get stuck with one set of prescriptions. If the sector demand that changes are needed according to the situation. So we should be able to change our policy prescriptions also. Because basically it's an administrative, because it's not a legislative document. So anytime we can bring in necessary amendments, necessary additions to the policy to achieve the overall objective and goal of our policies that will benefit the management of forests and wildlife in the country. I think I had I had taken much time so it's one man, so it's like a monologue. So I think I would like to conclude here. If any few questions, if any or clarifications are needed, if I can clarify on that, I would be very happy to do that. If anyone of the participants having any pertinent issues or questions on the process or program or the existing policy, I would be very happy to clarify the same. So I thank you once again. I would be taking questions, if any, so that I can clarify if the participants have got some doubts, or I would be very happy to help out. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Noel sir, once again, firstly for keeping the time, secondly for a very nice disclosure of the and like a travelogue, like traveling from the first pre-independence forest policy to the new one. And I'm very glad and proud to be knowing that you are mainly behind the new policy, which was put on the public domain for a long time, and many of us have already contributed to the document. And I also thank CTS Nile sir for patiently listening to his former peer, I guess. Then also Abhilash is one of our best friend from our own fraternity, who had been helping the college, sitting at the hem of FAS in the ICFR earlier. Now he is in the CAS force, I guess. And he will be speaking in another series later on. And he must also be having his own viewpoints of the policies and other things revolving around the Indian forestry sector, and also about forestry education in particular. I as such don't see any technical questions on the chat box. So I request CTS Nair sir, I know you should be the first one to ask questions, and we have already raised the hands. I request CTS Nair sir to come in. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Noel sir, once again. CTS Nair, it seems you are muted.
Yeah,
now it's okay, sir. No, still not audible. You seem
to be... Sir's earphones are not compatible with the system he is using.
No, I don't hear CTS Nair sir.
Are you able to hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. First and foremost, let me thank Noel for an excellent presentation. I think you provided a beautiful sort of historical presentation. In a way, I'm happy that you are looking after the revision of the 1988 forest policy, because I was involved in the 1988 forest policy in the final stages. And when you described the kind of issues, I feel that what we did in 1988, especially the finalization stage, I was a DIG in charge of forest policy in the ministry. At that time, relatively it was simple. When we consider the complexities facing the reason being is that 1988, when the issue was that we are really moving away from the timber-based management to a more environment-friendly management. And fortunately, we had the Prime Minister himself was in charge of forestry. So So we could sort of really convince him that it is really moving into focusing on the ecological dimension. And in fact, once Prime Minister agrees with that, practically no one sort of really objects to that. So this is the reason why we are able to sort of take the policy through without much of a problem. But now I see you have enormous challenges. I mean, in terms of how to sort of balance the conflicting demands. And I think that's really difficult. And the other issue is that it's not just the forest policy. Now, we have to really look at what exactly is the development policy, the industrial policy, the trade policy. All those things are going to, and even if you have a robust approved forest policy, we are not sure whether you'll be able to actually implement it on the ground because the pressures are going to be enormous. So I think this is something which is very interesting, and I think all of us should be really aware that what happens in forestry will be largely decided by what happens outside the forestry. And I think this is something we should have to keep in mind. Now, I have only one question that I'd like to raise to you. Now, 1988 policy, we moved away from timber production. Now, what are you planning to do with the timber production in the new forest policy? Because what I see is that timber is emerging as one of the most environment-friendly material, especially in the context of climate change. And considering that our per capita forest area is extremely low, we still need to sort of make sure that we have timber production. We cannot really, you know, we have been depending on outside, I mean, importing from Malaysia, Papua New Guinea, Myanmar, and see, 80% I think produced in Latin America is coming to India. Now, that being the situation, how are we able to sort of manage this issue on meeting the timber demand? Because there is no escape for us from meeting the, in the 1988 policy, the pressures were much less. We had a very pro-environment friendly, in a political system, and we completely moved away from that. But now I think we have to really go back and do a bit of balancing. So I would really like to know what are your views on this. Thank you. And very good presentation. I'm very happy that you are sort of spearheading the new forest policy. And I really feel happy that, you know, something which I did a little bit in 1988, now it is being taken over by someone from Kerala again.
So thank you, CTO sir. Yes, it was a very difficult exercise. So, saying to everyone in the ministry, say that 30 years back, things were slightly okay. The conservation scenario, you know, everybody was in that more focus on conservation issues, conservation scenario was bright and better. Or during that period, and of course Prime Minister himself was handling the subject, means that makes the process very smooth and easy. But as that said, so that, now the issue is our ministry, the mandate of making forest policy is the mandate of Ministry of Environment and Forest. Unfortunately, the problem is that, you know, what we say in the last 4 years, each and every ministry, each and every sector wanted to dictate what should be there in the forest policy. That was a very, see, that shows the concern of others. And so, but now we have to take a, and the highest level also, they were also not able to. This has come up for approval, final approval, many times. So each time I send the cabinet proposal, it's equivalent to 2 trees. As I am using that much paper for putting this for approval, so you can imagine our difficulty. But we tried to have a balanced view. Because nowadays, you know, many very strong lobby feel that, you know, it would be better, the forest can be better managed by not only through JFM, even though JFM, everybody recognized that JFM has been a success, around 22 million hectare is under management of joined forest management. It has tremendously helped in states like Andhra Pradesh, Odisha, Jharkhand, West Bengal, etc. So coming back to the present, the under the policy, the draft policy which we are discussing. So we are, in fact, we are given more focus for production of timber from those areas, especially the plantations. So we all know that a large area of reserve forests are still under degraded plantations. Around 1.2 million hectare is available with the state forest corporations. Many of them are doing very bad, financially very bad these days because of various reasons, because the ban on filling and the time non-preparation of working plans and management plans. Even forest corporations need management plans for working their area, because these all things, you know, that our Godavaraman case made another after 1980, the Forest Conservation Act. I would say the next the major you can say management prescription was the Godavaraman case. That case is still live, and see how the judicial and the now the judiciary has taken over the executive functions to a great extent. So that Godavaraman case also partly responsible for our you can say we are not able to take up the scientific management of our plantations. And now, of course, the converting natural forest is ruled out, that we are not advocating now converting natural forests into plantations anymore. Whatever plantation, we have enough of areas under degraded plantations, especially with the corporations. And many states departments are managing plantations, the JFM areas. These are the areas, it will be around 40-50% of our reserve forest areas. 30-40 million hectare is already available. If we put 10 million hectare in a high-tech or a productive forestry, and then our timber requirements will be taken care of. That's what we have prescribed or proposed in our new draft policy, and for which we suggested that multi-sectoral participation of stakeholders would be required. It can be community, they can lead in some area if they are capable of managing and taking up, or through partnership with other private sector, they can also come in with the communities. And JFM areas, they can try on, and so that when the existing degraded low productive forest plantation areas should be brought under highly productive, fast growing, especially the major agroforestry species, industrial species, and even teak can be tried for different purposes, 10 year, 20 year rotation. So you can try short rotation, you cannot try. So all these things we have suggested in our new policy. So basically a community driven plantation program or management of degraded forest areas that we have proposed in our new coming up policy. And we said that already I would like to share that the central PWD, they have already issued that an order for using wood in all their construction. That was stopped earlier when the 88 policy he said that wood is not good. We should go for wood alternatives. So now we are, so that we reverse that. Now we said that wood is good and it's a more carbon neutral and we should promote use of wood. So hopefully it all, now one administrative action has already happened from CPWD side. So hopefully more will take up plantations, and we are trying to convince the major paper, pulp, and plywood industry people to have partnership with the local community and or groups and have community forestry, farm forestry, agroforestry, and so that more and more in their area where the units are situated, the produce should be, raw material should be made available there itself, so that it is a viable proposition. So we are given advocated for use of wood and promotion of wood and increasing the productivity of our existing plantations in the proposed policies. So I think I have clarified your query, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, Noel, sir. I have indeed, it's a pleasure on behalf of our Dean, Honorable Vice Chancellor has just joined us, and he has been very keen in attending this series. He had attended the first lecture, in fact, he inaugurated it. And on behalf of the college and the Dean, I welcome Dr. R. Chandrababu, our Honorable Vice Chancellor. He has been a constant inspiration and support to the College of Forests and the Faculty of Forestry, and that's been very encouraging to all of us. And just for as an introduction, I would like to say that our Honorable Vice Chancellor is a well-known international personality, and he had been formerly in the University of Tamil Nadu Agricultural University, but now as a Vice Chancellor has completed almost 3 years, and he had been a full drive fellow in the University of Cornell and a visiting professor in several Western universities, especially the University of Cornell itself, and Tokyo University, not to speak of many other things. I think Honorable Vice Chancellor will be having a few questions, if not to interact with Noel, sir, who is the Inspector General of Forests at the moment, who is a speaker also. Completed right on time.
Sri Noel Thomas, Inspector General of Forest, I'm very happy that you could share your valuable time and experience with our faculty, students, and other participants. I really appreciate your coming forward through this seminar. Yeah, I was listening to your it is recorded, not echoing.
No, sir, it's recorded, but you are very much audible.
Yeah, can I continue?
Yes, sir, sure.
Yeah, your talk was very comprehensive, and I think many of our faculty would have been benefited. Only just I don't have any questions or something like that. As a learner, forestry education. Okay, I understand. Okay. Yes, I'm continuing. Okay, yeah. So forestry education, even this agriculture education, only recently we are taking into schools. But whereas the forestry, I think the education itself is important, is confined to the forest areas. As we talk about social forestry, community forestry, and agroforestry, etc. But I want to say, because the land, there is a rising, increasing competition for land for various activities, not only for human dwelling, industry, tourism, many other purposes. So the land being a finite resource, and we need to have a forestry also. Yeah, 1/3 of that land area should be under forest for a ideal environment. So how to actually make these things compatible, the needs of other community dwellings, industries, and as well as a forest ecosystem. So can we bring this forestry into urban ecosystem? I learned about urban forestry, etc., and I learned that you are from our state, and our state is highly vulnerable to the environmental calamities, you know, landslide and flooding, so much things. So how to increase urban resilience using a forest as a major intervention? Thank you.
Yeah. I would like to clarify our proposed policy is also talking about urban greens, promotion of urban greens. So, and we have already launched Nagar One, it's an urban forest in selected municipal and even in the corporation in municipalities and corporations, wherever public land is available, like creating public parks. Government of initial period, Government of India will support. Then along that will be a multi-stakeholder partnership. This is being proposed to be taken up with the participation of local bodies, local resident welfare associations, and all NGOs and others, so that the area will be earmarked. The local bodies will make available the area. Ministry will support the initial infrastructure and setting up, and other RWA, local NGOs, other conservationists, all will join together to bring up more greenery in that area. That is one thing which is being given importance and stress now. And the second thing, we are advocating the present new policy prescription also says skilling or supporting the local people who are forest dependent people, so that their livelihood issues are also addressed, especially the tribals and traditional forest dwellers. So yes, the forestry is getting mainstreamed into all the local body plan and programs. So then only we will have a convergence of all the activities. Then increasing forest area as such, we also recognize that it is a difficult proposition, and even reaching 33%. But that is our goal. But we are proposing that we should have more trees outside forest. That the ecosystem services which trees and or woodlots, that would be compensating most of the services from the forest areas. So we are not saying that we should bring more agricultural area or productive area back to forestry, but we say that you have more farm forestry, agroforestry, and urban woodlots, public parks, urban greens, etc. So that we would be able to, because if you see the last few cycle of forest cover estimation, so you can see that the growth of trees outside forest is enormous these days. You know, we are bringing out more policy and legal facilitation. I'm very happy to say that most of the 28, 29 states already removed all the felling transit restrictions of most of the 100% agroforestry species so in the country. So the restriction as such per se is not there in most of the states. Now the Government of India has already launched one portal that is under testing now in two states. So that anybody, any farmer, any wood grower, tree grower can, without visiting the forest offices, they can submit all their required documents, details online. And if the forest officials or the forest department, local level, if they have any issue with it, like within 15 days or a reasonable 3 weeks time, they should clear it. Otherwise, automatically the permission will be granted online to the people, so that there will be a mobile app also, so that people can transport their material all across the country without like GST. There will be no check post that you will be retained for 2 days, 3 days like that. So all are being done away with. So every forest check post or border check post, they will simply scan the that QR code that is available in their mobile app or the mobile phone. So they will be allowed to move across. So once you scan the QR code, you will get all the information on the produce you are carrying, where from it is collected, what is the route, where it is going, what is the quantity, and what is the total amount, all those things, details of the person who is transporting, details of the person from where it is collected, everything will be available in the mobile app so that there will be no restriction on movement also. So that will also add to the new facilitation. So I hope that with all these things, our agroforestry, farm forestry, homestead forestry, and all these things will take care of our requirement of tree cover, so that we may achieve or near to 33%. So we hope that that will happen maybe in 10 to 20 years time. We should be able to maintain that much of tree cover. If not the forest area, we are not saying forest area increase, but it's a difficult proposition. Increasing legal forest area beyond, so we can bring in some extent, but we can't expect to increase the forest area geographically, in terms of geographical area. But we are looking forward for promoting the trees outside forest. That will take care of the requirement of our commitments and requirement for the ecosystem services. Thank you.
Anup sir, can I make an intervention? Anup sir? Hello? Anup sir is not audible.
Yeah, sir, Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, your question is answered. Do you have any more?
Yeah, it is not for question answer. Just I want to learn from our IG. That's all. Yeah.
So thank you, sir. Now, I before Kunyama, sir, he is trying to ask a question. Here we have another of the invited speaker will be speaking, I think, on the fourth session. Sri Abhilash Damodaran, who also is again from the College of Forestry. He is an IFS man. He was ADG of Education in the ICFR, the Indian Council of Forestry Research and Education, and a very good friend. And in fact, he is a student of many of the faculty here. I think he had been patiently listening right from the beginning to this seminar by Noel sir. Over to Abhilash. Sorry, Kunyam sir, I'll get back very shortly after Abhilash has questions. Okay, Abhilash.
Thank you, Anup sir, Honorable Vice Chancellor Sri Dr. Chandrababu Ranganathan sir, the guest of the day, Noel Thomas sir, and I have heard him on several other occasions, and it's an opportunity to, you know, sit, even though it's on an online platform, across with Dr. CTS Nair sahab. I have read his paper about the changing scenarios in forestry, in the forest department. I have read a paper about that previously. Dean Dr. Vikasaran sir, who was also my guide for my project work, and I enjoyed working with him in the Wet Evergreen Forest of Varchal, and all the respected faculty of my alma mater, and all the esteemed participants of this webinar. It was wonderful listening to Noel Thomas sir, as usual, and since he is heading the law and policy wing of the ministry. Sir, since and Anup sir just flagged that previously I was working as ADG Education in ICFRE, so I just had some maybe query or some maybe or something like that. Like the forest policy, somewhere the draft forest policy 2018 somewhere mentions, maybe paragraph 4 point something, mentions about education. research and education, but it's not very clear how we plan to bring about a reform in the education sector, in the forestry education sector. Like sir, over the past few years, since 2015, you know, forestry education sector under ICFRA has taken a severe hit. ICFRA is not able to support education in our country, forestry education in our country, and there has been a mushrooming of several institutions across the country. Especially I have seen it in this Dehradun belt. There would be at least 25-30 institutions under the private sector that are offering graduate and postgraduate courses in forestry. And I myself, being a graduate and postgraduate in forestry, I know the kind of infrastructure, the kind of facilities, the kind of labs, the kind of field, the kind of tours and exposure that is required to make a good forestry graduate that we have in the agricultural universities across the country. But I have seen that these newly mushroomed colleges over the past decade, they are ill-equipped. And how does the policy, the National Forest Policy, address these things? Does it speak about any accreditation? It doesn't speak about any accreditation of quality institutions in forestry. It doesn't speak obviously it will be a fallout of the policy later on, but I would be more interested that how we plan to strengthen ICFRE. Like, agriculture sector has got ICR as its godfather, engineering sector has got AICT as its godfather, and so and so forth. The Veterinary Council and the Medical Council of India, they're all godfathers, but still forestry is finding it very difficult to find a godfather. Like, sometimes I don't know whether I am right or wrong, but it sometimes we feel that we are adopted children of ICAR. So, but that's not true, though. But sometimes ICFRE should be taking a bigger role, and the ministry and the forest and the policy should be supporting ICFRE to assume that larger role. Sir, please comments on this, sir.
Yeah. Thank you, Abhilash. This is an issue. I think maybe in the last 10 years or so, the focus on the supporting forestry education, unfortunately, I think ministry also did not. That is one reason. What I find here is the if you see the funding, it more or less stagnated in the last few years, if you see. Unfortunately, we could not get external aided projects also. Earlier, ICFRE used to manage supporting externally aided program, except for the, the JICA, JICA aided upgradation programs for the forestry institutions in the country. That was only one thing I could see the last 5 years, 6-7 years. That is only for the field level training of field level functionaries and their institution, USFS colleges, rangers colleges, as well as forestry training institutes. But per se, ICFRE, I didn't see much of the improvements that could happen in the last few years, and that is one issue. But here, present policy, we are talking about strengthening the research and education sector, and giving more skilling of the other stakeholders also, so that this ICFRE will get more role, especially in the training of the field functionaries, and more of research activities. And recently, again from the Common Secretary of Forestation Program, that CAMBA fund, ICFRE is being given some few 130 crore or something for taking up detailed plan preparation and support, technical supporting the state forest, 7-8 forest departments for the catchment areas of major rivers in the country. So that is a one development, recent development But I would say that ministry could not know. Basic issue is, you know, you should ensure employment to the forestry professionals, whoever is coming out at graduate level, postgraduate level, their employment opportunities should be ensured. But unfortunately, we could not assured employment to all the people who are passing out. Even for agriculture, that's an issue nowadays. Maybe I'm told the last 10-15 years, you know, agriculture graduates are also not getting absorbed. That's so catchment is only like a captive placing was there available in the agriculture departments all over the country, but that is limited. The number of graduates coming out is much more. So that is an issue, and the other opportunities are limited. And the research, then the next opportunity is only for the research organizations. That also, you know, that there is a limited capacity. Unless what has happened in the 80s with the initiating the forestry colleges and other forestry education in a large scale in the country. Something like that should happen. But now what we are trying to advise through this, you know, policy that all should be, there should be more institutions for skilling people, and all forest certification also, we would be requiring a lot of manpower, trained, qualified manpower, that we are trying to develop our own. The government is not supporting the international certification per se. We are trying to have ICFRE or the IIFM and the state agri universities to ask the certifying bodies. So all these things would require more manpower, qualified manpower, so that in future, maybe in the years to come, the sector will get further focus and attention. It requires, and of course, funding, and ICFRE also and should look forward to generate own funds. Nowadays, the mantra here in the government of India is you should generate your own 20%, 30%. Expenditure should be met from own funds. So generating through consultancies or other programs or through projects, and now that has become this ministry is also advocating all BSI, ZSI and all other institutions generate your own income partially. But to what extent that will happen, that's a big question mark also. So hopefully some things will move positively, and ICFRE also should take up this challenge and move ahead. Thank you.
Thank you, Noel sir, and Abhilash for the very
kind, sir. Anup sir, I would like to just continue with one or make a couple of sentences more, sir. Okay. I would request Noel Thomas sir that if again the draft policy is pushed to the cabinet, sir, and if possible, I would just like to have one more sentence inserted under paragraph 4.5, where the forestry professionals and graduates and professionals, the state government should absorb them, and find avenues for them. This one particular sentence is a must as the conclusion to paragraph 4.5 of the National Forest Policy, sir, draft forest policy.
No,
thank you very much. That's, I think you are one of the most patriotic alumni for college, for us.
Policy that will become an action point, no? That you are then specifically prescribing, then you have to prescribe for each and every act, strategy, no? What are the interventions you are going? So your policy will be 50 pages, no? So that's why we thought about it. We said, that's why, you know, we only broadly said that it should be ensured so that it should follow. It's an action which will follow after the adoption of the policy.
Thank you, sir. Over to Punyama, sir. Punyama, sir, are you there?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you very much, Anup, sir. Respected Noel Thomas, sir. Respected Vice Chancellor. I'm so glad that Noel Thomas, sir, made a very comprehensive presentation about the future perspectives of forestry education and policy in India per se. In this context, I would like to make some suggestions that see, if you look at the whole forest scenario in the country, even the both all the three policies has been focusing primarily on the forestry conservation as well as production forestry within the boundaries of the limits of the forest. Now, recently there was a talk by Dr. Shibu Jose, and in many other Western countries, the concept of forestry has already undergone a paradigm shift from the conventional boundaries of forest to agro ecosystems. Right, as our Vice Chancellor rightly said, you see, there is a need for the extension of the forestry beyond the limits of the forest. And definitely the policy decisions has been taken, as Noel sir said, some action plan has been taken. But that continuum of the forest ecology and the agroecology has to be bridged through effective policy decisions. Of course, it is emerging, but it has not gone to the level of other countries. For instance, Noel sir has already mentioned about the trees outside the forest. If you look at the scenario, you can see that except for states like Kerala, some of the northeastern states and Goa, the tree cover in the dual sector has not gone beyond 10%. So there is an enormous opportunity that is existing. Now, it is a fact that DIF is increasing very well over the past couple of years. But the question is, who is going to guard, or who is going to be the custodian of the trees outside the forest? For example, in the agriculture sector, there is an agriculture department who is taking care of that. But in the TOF sector, there is neither the agriculture department nor the forestry department is exclusively responsible for the trees. I'm speaking about the agroforestry. Of course, the forest department has got the social forestry programs, other kinds of forestry department related programs. But agroforestry is primarily in the farmland, in the farmer's land, and the farmers does not have any idea about the fate of the trees. So I should say that most of the trees in the tree sector are orphans. There is no agency who is taking care of these trees. So in this context, for example, Kerala Agricultural University College of Forestry and many other state agricultural universities have suggested their respective governments to employ suitable qualified forestry personnel in agroforestry and related aspects at local self-government levels, like panchayats. At panchayat levels, we have an agriculture expert. At panchayat level, we have veterinary expert. At panchayat level, we have fisheries expert, all kinds of it. But there is no forestry expert who attend the forestry, the trees in the farmlands, and they say that, okay, these trees are to be managed this way, or tree husbandry has to be a very serious professional activity. And unfortunately, there is nobody to take care of that. So my request with Noel Thomas sir is that, what is the, especially entrepreneurial development of entrepreneurial skills of forestry graduates. We always think about it should go to the forest or the forest department or the experts should be, experts must be catering the needs of the forest. But there must be sufficient forestry experts who cater the needs of the trees outside the forest, in the villages, in the farmlands, etc. Unfortunately, we don't have any policy directives for that. And this is in fine tune with what Abhilash also has suggested. Why can't the government of India make a policy directive to the states, requesting that the forestry graduates must be employed at village levels or at panchayat levels, so that their services, especially in the context of the changing climate, as our Vice Chancellor rightly said, there is an enormous change that is happening in the agro ecosystems, primarily because of the changes of climate changes, and these forests are responsible for maintaining them. So maintenance of the health of the forest, maintenance of the health of the agro ecosystems, these are very closely linked. What are the strategies we have in employing such manpower in this sector, sir?
Yeah, thank you, Kunyamu. Yes, utilizing the services of the trained and forestry professionals is very important. We have been talking about this when the Indian Institute of Forest Management that was set up. So to take up the skilled professionals or supply skilled professionals to the industries and other agencies who are in the domain of taking up agroforestry plantations and also forest-based industries. But unfortunately, this is an issue because not all the forest, the states are having or panchayats are having forest to ensure that people dedicated professional to be employed. Of course, some areas, some panchayats or villages or it can be, they can hire people. One thing I would suggest that it would be better if forestry professionals can take up employment in rural panchayat, some sort of preference is given to them. Then horticulture department, soil conservation department. Of course, agriculture department is basically for the agriculture graduates, but forestry graduates also should be able to compete there or should be selected there because considering the agroforestry aspect. And Government of India, because agroforestry is a subject officially dealt by Agriculture Ministry. So we have one mission, sustainable submission on agroforestry is already running, but it's a very small mission. Kerala, of course, earlier in the beginning, Kerala participated for 1-2 years that I could see from their progress report. Then Kerala did not come forward to because the kitty was very small. So they also did not show any interest. Then the bamboo mission, the new bamboo mission, that is one thing where the forestry graduates can, they can get, I doubt whether now in the new scheme of things, whether like a government permanent postings will be there or not. That is an issue to be addressed now. But Bamboo Mission is talking about value addition, cluster development, and promotion of bamboo-based the institutions. So there also National Bamboo Mission also is an avenue where people can be utilized. But I would say that no, nowadays no, it is multidisciplinary. Now it is not like convergence of all the streams. So it is not, otherwise it's a very core this thing, like even agriculture, basically forestry graduates also learn minimum like engineering, all the basic engineering subjects will be taught to all the streams of engineering. No? So like that, agriculture is also being taught to forestry graduates in the, I think one or two few papers are also there for forestry graduates. So that these are the avenues one should look forward. Certainly, after the approval of the policy, the directives will follow and the advisories and directives will follow so that the states can take up. Or absorb the qualified professionals, especially as I said earlier, the certification because and the NTFP is going to get more thrust in the coming because we are talking of more and more value addition, and instead of exporting raw material, so now under Make in India and other the looking inside policy, so hopefully things will get more support in the coming days. So I feel that we should not get disappointed. Certainly the directives will follow after the approval of the policy. So how to ensure the engagement of qualified and trained forestry professionals in the country. That agroforestry and trees outside forest is getting a thrust, but I doubt to what extent states will be able to engage full-time professionals, but at least on a mission mode or project mode, quite a number of people can be engaged for implementing certain policies, programs, etc. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. There are a few questions in the chat box, but before I go into a few of them, I would like to inform the audience that a link has been shared by the organizers where you can fill in the feedback of the entire webinar series. I think it's better to fill the entire webinar series after all of them are over. There are three lined up every week, every Friday, 10 a.m. The next one is by very own CTS Nair sir, sitting here, and followed by Abhilash, also here, and then by Dr. Animo. You can put your feedback in the feedback form. Now I will take the questions from the chat box. This is the first one is by Sridhar Bhatt. He's from the College of Forestry, Sirsi. Sir, in our forest policies and steps, especially the FRA 2006, the damage that forest fragmentation, such as honeycombing of habitat by people settlements, does to large wild animals is very poorly acknowledged, and it is being a damage to wildlife conservation. This is the question that is basically put forward. He has also put forth another question to Abhilash. I think they are answering between themselves. So the first question, sir, you can also look at the chat box to fully understand what Mr. Bhatt wants to know.
Because this is the issue related to the fragmentation and degradation due to the implementation of the Forest Rights Act 2006. Yes, it's a reality that enclosures are there well within deep inside the forest areas, especially in the Western Ghat region, Eastern Ghat region, and many Central Indian places. Partially, it's all due to encroachment, and because the tribals and they occupy deep inside forest, it's natural that once you grant the rights to them, unless they move out, so it will be like a honeycombing. So we can't help it, because Forest Rights Act, to that extent, Forest Rights Act will prevail, because the as far as the rights are given, if they have got genuine rights, you have to honor that right and you have to give them. But the opportunity is still there. You can, from the critical wildlife habitats, people can be brought out after settling their rights and compensating them. So that option is there if they are agreeable, voluntarily, if they agree for that, so that the fragmentation as well as the honeycombing can be minimized. That option is available, but we can't prevent granting rights to the tribals if they are legally, if they qualify under Forest Rights Act prescriptions.
Thank you, sir. There's a question from Dr. R. Nageshwari Tagore. Sir, what are the provisions in the forest policy to protect the farmers and crops from attack of forest animals in the nearby holdings? I don't know whether this is a question that can be answered so easily, especially the policy.
Yeah, the policy is also talking about landscape. Wildlife management will be on a landscape basis. So landscape means agricultural, horticultural, and other related activities also. So obviously, this is the most important issue nowadays, because I look after the human-elephant conflict issues in the country. Because you should know that on an average, 100 plus people are dying every year due to elephant attack. And more than 500 elephants are also getting killed in retaliation, because people are putting poison, people are electrocuting animal, and people do others. Poaching is very limited, but these two things, poisoning and electrocution, these two are accounting for 80 elephant deaths in the country. So I stand corrected. 500 human beings are getting killed and 100 elephants are getting killed in the country. That's the statistics. Yes, we are talking about the habitat management and trying to contain the elephants, and elephant is the most important animal as far as the conflict is concerned. So trying to contain the elephants within the its natural habitat by improving the habitat, and safeguarding the villages and other areas where the habitations are there. Either we are advocating that people should move out to peripheries or where we can consolidate and protect their properties through physical barrier. Otherwise, we are saying that putting up barriers around their physical barriers around their habitation, so that entry of animal can be checked. So, but again, there is a lot of opposition against putting a physical barrier to people say that no, you are breaking the continuity and movement pattern of the elephants. We should, yes, we are coexisting, that is true. But for that, both elephants and human beings should survive. So, you know, the elephant is a wild animal, so we can't reason with elephant. So we can only guide them to take the natural course of movement. So it is an encroachment, and in all the corridors we know that there are encroachments and corridors are blocked, so the elephants are getting stranded and stuck up in isolated patches. That is leading to more and more conflict. So we are trying to legally strengthen the corridor, the critical corridors in the country, so that the animal movement will, traditional movement will go on without hindrances, so that the issues can be resolved. Then unfortunate cases of death and other issues, we are trying to compensate, and by providing ex gratia as well as property for compensation for property damages. So these are a few of the things which we are trying to address this issue. Anyway, it's a reality, and you know that elephant population from 15,000, we are reached 30,000 in the last 40 years. So that, and 60% of the Asian elephant population is in our country. So rest 13 out of the 13 elephant range states in the region, India is only one country where elephant is still protected, and their status is the highest in the country compared to other range countries. So, but elephant is part and parcel of our life, because it's culturally, and the most the most venerated and most culturally attached with the human beings. So it's part of our life. So we have to take care of our national heritage animal also.
I have a small question.
Yeah, sir, please, sir.
My question is that with regards to the draft forest policy 2018, in which it is mentioned that the PPP model. So the fear is that, as I mentioned in my welcome address, can we substitute our constructed capital over natural capital? Because I fear that by bringing this PPP model in the natural systems or forest systems, especially in the scenario of climate change. So how this particular model will work in the natural systems, that I fear that will cause a lot of damage to the existing natural system. As we know, in Chhattisgarh and all the coal mines, spreading coal mines, you know, taking up large extent of forest areas. And many times, you know, the Conservation Act 1980, you know, that is a very pathetic situation, you know, that that is not enforcing, that particular Conservation Act is not being enforced in many forest areas of Chhattisgarh. That is what we read in the newspaper. So this PPP model, what will be the impact of this PPP model in the natural systems?
So thank you, Vidya Sagar. We are not advocated or advocating for PPP in the natural forest management per se. We are only saying that in order to increase the productivity of plantations, that's where we propose that we may go for public private participation model. We said that primarily this should be taken up outside forest areas. Revenue recorded forests are there, but that is not declared as reserve forest. There are revenue forests in the country. There are scrub and degraded forest areas which are not wildlife habitat or ecologically important, that much of ecologically important by way of biodiversity, etc. And areas available with the local communities, common areas are there in many states. So these are the areas where we are suggested that we may go for partnership. But of course, this is only suggested, this thing, not in natural forest areas or wildlife rich areas or biodiversity rich areas. Even though Western models speak of all our, you know, that all the Latin American as well as North America or the Southeast Asian region, natural forests are also given to concessionaires, different. So that is a model, that is a PPP is already practiced in all Southeast Asian countries, and like Malaysia, Indonesia, and they had a very bad experience with it. Now their recent policy documents show that they are also moving away from this, their particular model where large-scale plantation natural area was given to private people for extraction and regeneration. But unfortunately, extraction happened, but regeneration did not happen to the extent desired, which resulted in degradation. And so Indonesia and other countries, Malaysia, now they have learned the lesson now. That's what the recent documents say. So we can't afford to go in that model. So after a lot of discussion and this thing, that we will not be going for any private, like what Malaysia did or Indonesia did, or other Brazil is doing. We can't advocate such a thing in India. Even with very conservative thing, we are not able to satisfy each and every sector. So that is not an issue. It's only a limited purpose. and especially for increasing the productivity of our degraded. Otherwise, that area is not neither producing good quality timber or other forest produce. It's just lying like a degraded area. So if somebody come with enough resource, and because forest departments are 30-40% short of their manpower, vacancies are not filled, people are not there. So, and the state is not able to pay salary to all or recruit more people. So we have to look to at least rehabilitate our failed plantation. That I said that 1.2 million hectares available with our forest corporations. So at least you try to do something in those areas so that we should be able to meet the timber requirements of the country. And we should not forget that we are importing 50,000 crore worth timber every year, timber and timber products to the country. So whether we should still go for that or we should promote our trees outside forest, raise the productivity of our plantations, failed plantations, degraded areas. And so we will not be advocating, or nor we have advocated, this participation, private participation in natural forest management. It is not advocated or prescribed. We are not suggested.
Thank you.
Thank you. If there are no more questions from the audience as such, I will just go over to one more question in the chat box, which is again from the College of Forestry, Sirsi. This is some interesting question related to forest management certification. So the question is any initiation in forest policy towards forest management certification? This is the question from Vinayak Upadhyay.
Yes, the draft policy is also, we have made a prescription regarding the forest certification. So not exactly forest management certification, it's a forest certification. Basically what we suggested to the agencies which tried to develop India-specific criteria and indicators based on which the certification will be done. We told them very clearly, we had an extensive discussion also, that it has to be like a single produce certification may not be a very appropriate thing. Like European countries and others, they are focusing on timber, the plantation timber and that certification. But what we suggested here is we should go for like that particular or Nelambur forest, so it should be certified. So that forest area in that Malappuram district should be certified. So like that, so that all the product and services coming from that area will be certified, so that others, so it is sustainably, basically certification is nothing but saying that it is sustainably managed. The products and services are coming out from sustainably managed forest resource. So that's all. That's basically certification is that only. So it has taken care of the people issues, the labor, sustainability is practices, you know, destructive practices are not utilized for harvesting or value addition. And while raising the plantation or managing the natural area, no destructive practices employed or utilize, or people, the local people, their interests are protected, the labor and social other issues are legally protected, and that is how you are managing and producing certain products and services. That's what you are certifying. So if an area is certified, so that one particular patch of reserve forest, so 5,000 hectare or 10,000 hectare, if that is certified, then all the products and services will also get automatically get the tag of that certification. So that will give you an improved market, or people will like your honey. If the forest honey is already honey from a particular region, forest area, you can market it with a certification. So sustainably managed, the honey coming from sustainably managed forest area of Vadachal or Trivandrum, Palod or those areas. So you certify it like that. And the other medicinal plants products coming from that area. So if you go for a geographical region or that particular reserve forest area as a whole, get it certified, then all the products and services will be automatically benefited. And the whatever value addition in terms of financial returns, that should also go to the local people. That's what we are proposing.
Thank you very much, sir, for a very good question, and that was answered very nicely. As you rightly said, there is huge potential for certification of NTFP than timber or the forest management unit certification as such. So I think we have had a very long session, and still I find that a lot of questions are there in the chat box, which will definitely be answered. We will be forwarding into Noel sir a few of the relevant questions. Some of them I find that there are no question and answers between themselves, so that will not be going to the Q&A report to Noel sir, but definitely you can give your questions in the feedback form also, not only entirely about the webinar series, but questions also can be typed in, I think. Noel sir, let me on behalf of the College of Forestry, the Kerala Agriculture University, and the Honorable Vice Chancellor, our respected Dean Vidyasagar sir, who had persistently wanted to organize this very important workshop, and we picked up the right persons, and I think that well begun is half done. We started off with a big very very good session of Shibu Jose. Now this was also very revealing. In fact, we have been only on the periphery of the policy, new policy. We didn't know much about the policy as such, but now we have heard from the horse's mouth. So there are many questions still to be answered, but I think you have taken it very seriously this session, and your official engagements and other difficulties in the capital, despite that you've been on time, and you kept the time of your session also very well. Since there was no PowerPoint, this is something which we are now getting used to, and there is too much of PowerPoints, and there is no point in the power, but we are losing our power when we are shown PowerPoints every time. But you spoke simply from your own notings, and then answered all the questions very well. We are indeed really proud of you. We still remember our memories of you reaching us, reaching your room, and you will be always with a book or something, reading through it, and always targeted, focused on getting through the Indian Forest Service examination. And he set a very good example of how hard work and toil can take you to the topmost echelons of the sector you're working. Thank you very much, sir, on behalf of the entire fraternity in Forestry College in Kerala Agriculture University, and the Honorable Vice Chancellor. Thank you very much, sir. I also would like to thank our respected Vice Chancellor, who inaugurated the webinar and was listening to the webinar initially, I think, through live streaming, but he came in directly with the link for making some comments and trying to understand things from you. That was also motivating for us, and thanks also goes to our dean, who is actually the leader who leads us despite our small petty differences and egos of mainly due to the subjects rather. Disciplines that we are in, he's trying to coordinate and trying to, as in Shibu had put it in the last session, trying to put everything in an umbrella of natural resource management rather than taking it out, separating out each discipline and being in a narrow compartments.
Thank you very much, sir, for being throughout the session and asking very important questions. Now I thank CTS Nair, sir, because I think he is a very patient listener and still at this stage also tries to learn and understand things. And I've been a great fan of him. I have listened to him not only in the country but abroad as well many times. And he was, as you all of you know, he was the chairman of the State Council of Science and Technology earlier. But he was the director KFRA. That is the first time when we met him. And the hairs were very dark at that time. And when I met him after so many years, I could not really understand, identify, sir, I live in an airport with his wife. And then that was after, I think, around 30 years that I met him personally. Of course, listening to him at several fora. Thank you very much, sir. We are eagerly looking forward to your next session next week, next Friday. That should be a really interesting session. Thanks also goes to Abhilash. Indeed, Abhilash is so selfless, if you ask for any help, not only official, like what he's arguing, so many people have put in the chat box as he is the one who put the forestry profession. The professions are right now without much of jobs in their hands, as it was not unlike the earlier times. And he is a constant motivator and supporter, and still argues without any professional compulsions or rather inhibitions. He plainly comes out and speaks for the forestry candidates. I think we are all proud of you, Abhilash. Thanks very much, and also we look forward to your very interesting, and you have a very good experience in the north, the Uttarakhand and the northern states, particularly you and Madhya Pradesh also, and also with the ICFRE and the CASFOs right now. I would also like to thank Kunyama sir, Goboma sir, who was there in fact in between, and Namir sir, Sandhu sir, and all senior faculty. And particularly the organizers. I'm only the moderator now. This is meticulously being organized by two people mainly. One is Dr. M. Shahji, Wildlife Department, and the other is Dr. Krishna Das. And so we have a kind of a professional team, although they are not IT people. They rightly conduct things, and in between, if there is any disruption and somebody is sharing a screen unknowingly, he's still taken out of the screen. And I thank them in particular, and also all the learned professors from other agriculture universities across the country and outside, and also the students who are very keenly listening to this session, because it is their cake too. Because once you complete the professional degree as a forestry professional, and still you are looking out for jobs in sectors which are unknown to you, then that is not a good thing. But with Abhilash, with Noel sir right now, we are really hopeful that things will change in the future. I thank each and everyone for actively participating in the session. The questions asked in the chat box will definitely be taken care of by the organizers. Thank you all once again. Have a good day.
Thank you.